The next point of my journey is the Grand Kremlin Palace. Usually, it is the venue for important state ceremonies. Mostly dignitaries are invited here, but in the past, children were also received. Thousands of them came to celebrate the New Year's festivities. The tradition of arranging holidays for children in the Kremlin dates back to more than 50 years. The first reception was in a Grand Kremlin Palace's largest hall, St. George's, in 1954. Back then, the giant Christmas tree was dragged directly up the stairs, through the front door, without much thought, for the ancient interior.
Over 60 meters deep, St. George's Hall is the size of a football pitch. A giant fir tree used to be mounted right here. And this massively heavy object used to be dragged across this parquet floor that was originally laid in 1845. When raised, it scraped the chandeliers, each one weighing 3 tons, by the way, and its tinkling produced an almost surreal, eerie chime. Also, large nails were hammered into this floor to fix this huge Christmas tree. The kids who danced and sang in this hall were asked not to shuffle because it would ruin the floor. Nevertheless, the interior was heavily damaged. Even I was asked to come in with soft indoor shoes, and I tried my best.
These walls honor the memory of heroes who received the Order of St. George for their courage. Anastasia Pavlova, a second-generation hall custodian, is also a fighter, but a fighter to preserve the hall's reconstruction. So what has changed after the reconstruction?
The parquet has definitely changed. They covered it with high-quality varnish to make it brighter. It's very rare 70% of the parquet has survived since 1845, when it was first laid. 30% of the flooring was replaced during restoration in 1968-1969. It took almost a year to restore St. George's Hall alone.
Children's parties were moved to a new building in the early 60s, the Kremlin Palace of Congresses, built under Khrushchev.
It's obvious that this building is from the Soviet era, and it stands in stark contrast with the Kremlin's architectural character. The palace used to be a key site for communist forums, and now it's the most prestigious musical venue in this country, and also a stage for the world's greatest artists. Charles Aznavour, Sting, Elton John, Tina Turner, you name it, they've all been here.
Right now, rehearsals are underway in the State Kremlin Palace for a New Year's performance for thousands of kids. Inside, we have an appointment with a Kremlin old-timer. Children's writer Alexander Kurlansky scripted the very first Soviet children's New Year party in 1954.
I think we've broken the Soviet tradition of staging performances here at the Kremlin. Before that, a boat would fire a shot. The tree would light up. Then kids would be shown a play with a revolutionary theme. Then I changed the plot. It was about a boy tired of his current situation. So in the story, he's sent into a different time. On one occasion, when I came to the New Year party, there was no carpet on the floor. I asked where it had gone. It turned out that during the show, some of the children had wet themselves on the carpet out of fear. It had to be washed and hung out to dry afterwards.
Nowadays, the New Year performances are more predictable, but still very colorful, nevertheless. By tradition, at the end of the show, the main character of the New Year's celebrations makes his grand entrance.
Happy New Year!
Children always leave Kremlin with gifts. However, the greatest drama is after the show, when parents surround the New Year's tree to pick the children up, who risk to disperse like ants in Kremlin's inner sanctum.
So how did you like the show? Was it okay, or did it give you a shock?
All right, so now it's about time to find out where one can eat in here. The Kremlin kitchen is not far, on the 5th floor of the State Kremlin Palace, and we're on our way to meet with a young Kremlin chef, Nikola Ott.
Hi.
Hello.
Sophie.
Nicholas, nice to meet you.
So you're the new chef everyone's talking about?
Yes, I am.
What's here?
So this is the cold section where we prepare mostly all the appetizers, all the fruit plates, all the vegetables. I can show you more.
Sure, let's go. What's over there?
This is our hot section. That's where we mostly prepare all
hot
soups, our main course. When everybody's here, it's 35 people at one time.
So you're the chef and you have 35 employees?
Yes.
Are they scared of you?
Little bit.
Yeah? So this is where all the sugar sins take place,
yes,
huh?
Yes, where we bake all our sweet goods.
So good!
And I want to show you where I have the privilege to work. We have a beautiful view of Moscow and landscape.
Wow. Usually you told me the kitchens are in a basement.
Nikolai promised me to teach how to cook one of President Medvedev's favorite dishes.
And I wanted to make some kind of pelmeni with a European touch. I work with Russian product and make it kind of French style.
For the stuffing, crab meat is mixed with vegetables and salad greens. Then it is put onto thinly rolled circles of dough. Shaping them by hands is real art.
I don't think I'm doing a very good job closing it.
Recent Russian presidents prefer healthy food and smaller portions. The Kremlin chef admits that Dmitry Medvedev is very fond of fish and seafood. For example, lobster salad. Vladimir Putin also prefers fish over meat. In the kitchen, they told us that he loves unsophisticated dishes like bread with herring, never refuses local delicacies on a business trips. So when someone in the countryside treats him with pickled cucumbers, also a traditional Russian delicacy, his security officers break into a cold sweat. As a rule, all meals are very carefully checked before it reaches the presidential mouth.
So what do? When you prepare for the president, you have like secret service guys and like lab people with their lab goggles x-raying your food?
It's not that complicated. They come and take samples of all our products to run just some basic analysis and make sure that nothing is bad or poisonous for our VIP people.
Alcohol is served only on festive occasions. Putin and Medvedev drink little on holidays. They prefer beer and wine. Boris Yeltsin was a lover of liquors, vodka and cognac. Secretary of State of the Soviet Union Nikita Khrushchev personally promoted vodka at international receptions. Thanks to him, vodka exports skyrocketed. We've prepared cream sauce with Parmesan cheese to go with ravioli. I guess I can say that I can feed the president now.
Are you gonna have some?
It's all yours.
I wanna live in Kremlin. This is so good.
After lunch, a nap is in order, perhaps in Tsar's bedroom. But I decided first to acquaint myself with those who watch over the peace and quiet in the Kremlin. A whole regiment of young soldiers live here, guarding the Kremlin and the president.
Bayonets!
The presidential regiment is rehearsing a performance with weapons. Denis and Klim are not only soldiers, but also honor guards. They protect the tomb of the unknown soldier at the eternal flame. Can you please show me some special tricks?
I can teach you if you want.
All right, let's do it.
The prep command is unfold the bayonet. Let me show you. Then up to the shoulder. Then to the foot. Hold the carbine with your right hand.
Not gonna cut myself, am I?
You won't cut yourself. Unfold it.
Wow.
Almost. Now shoulder the weapon. Lift it up. Hold it with your left.
I'm holding it.
Be careful, it should not lean on the left shoulder. This is the position in which we start the honor guard.
Young men between 18 and 20 are selected across the country for the presidential regiment. One can say that they are Russia's elite, in perfect health, with a good background and professional appearance. As for the guards, very handsome young men of similar heights are chosen so that they look like twins. Are there emergency situations when people break the existing rules, for example?
If people step over the chain, we warn them with this kind of signal. Tapping the rifle on the ground. The public immediately understands what this noise means and don't go any further.
The most frequent violators of the rules are young girls. They always try to flirt with the guards. But this is to no avail. The guards are not allowed to move, never mind smile. So here's your signature move. What is it about?
We raise the leg about 70, 80 degrees, move the body forward and put the full foot on the ground. This makes the foot you step with bend a little. And quick march. You're doing it well. You could join our company in a couple of months.
To the right.
It's time for the guys to prepare for the changing of the guard, but I couldn't miss a chance to take a look at their uniform wardrobe.
When it is cold, we wear ceremonial overcoats. The overcoats are very warm with Astrakhan collars.
Can I touch it?
Of course you can. When the temperature is 20 degrees below zero, we wear a warmer uniform called a bikesh. It is made of dense fabric, plus it has very warm fur. It feels hot in it even when it's minus 20.
Our journey into the heart of Kremlin is coming to an end, and it's time for me to move behind the Kremlin walls so I can make it for the changing of the guards.
The guard change every hour daily from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. These guys brave any weather, be it minus 30 in winter, torrential rains, outrageous heats in the summer. But of course, the hardest part is to stand there motionless no matter what. But hey, that's the price you pay to live rent-free inside the Kremlin.